Hello everyone, welcome to this video. My name is Ricardo Santos and this video is an overview of the Eridu Life project. I think it's important to do this video right on the beginning of the channel because this video is going to be a sort of a guide for the future content, because with this video you'll be able to understand what we have in the Finca right now and where things are located. And because there were so many questions on the video number one, the intention of that video was not to go through the details of the Finca and what we purchased, what we intend to do. It was more like a for show what we purchased. In this video here, we're gonna go more into details of what we have in the Finca and where things are located. And for more information about our Eridu Life project, check our blog. I'm going to leave the links down in the description, eridulife.com. There you're going to find information about us, about our backstory, why we decided to purchase this abandoned farm in Spain. And also I'm going to be putting a lot of contents, because on the winter days when I was in the Finca there, I have problem with the battery, so shooting a video, so I took a lot of pictures. Instead, some parts I do videos, I'm going to do articles, so I'm going to leave all the information down the blog. And also on the blog you can check our other social media links. And also if you would like to support the channel, there you're going to find the links as well for you to do that. I would like to give a note here before I start the content for this video. As I don't have yet a drone to do an aerial footage of the Finca, because of that I'm going to be using some satellite images from SIGPAC. If you don't know what SIGPAC is, it's an official Spanish government satellite which calls Sistema de Información Geográfica de Parcelas Agrícolas, which translates to Geographical Information System of Agricultural Plots. This is official Ministry of Agriculture satellite footage that we're going to be using here. And also to complement that, I'm going to be using the Google Earth. I don't have yet the drone and I don't have the best kit for doing the videos, because we're trying to do this project here debt free, and there are some priorities, and on this video you're going to see some of that priorities, and in future we're going to upgrade, but is not right now. I think it's important I leave this note here, because and then it's gonna make sense in down the road. Yeah, this video is gonna be cool the way I created the content. I think you enjoyed. So let's start it. This is Arusk land, which is located between two mountains that are part of a natural park, which is a protected area. Because it's a protected area, there are a lot of restrictions on what can be built or what can be restored or the way that can be restored. So because of these restrictions, we cannot do the job ourselves. We need a professional. That's why we hire an architect. In the future contents, I'm going to be talking about that, especially when it will be the restoration of the house. But, you know, it's a beautiful rustic piece of land. The land is around 11,560 square meters, which is 1.156 hectares. On the land, we have a lot of olive trees, some carob trees, some fruit trees, everything being abandoned for more than 100 years. There is a lot of work to do, but if we do step by step the way that I outlined on the videos that's going to come in soon, you're going to understand it's doable. And we're going to be doing on time. The plan really is to leave the land within the next 2 years. And I think that's doable. And you're going to understand on the future content how we're going to do that and the steps that we're going to take to achieve that. So I took this image from the land here back in September 2022. And it is amazing. So the views, the nature, and it's so much wild animals there, and we really pleased with the land. So let's check it out, what we have in this land now. For the demonstration purpose of this project overview video, I'm going to be using two sources of satellite image. One source is this image you see on the screen. This is from SIGPAC, which is the Spanish government official Ministry of Agriculture satellite image. It's a flat image. We're going to work on that image soon. You're going to see, we can see exactly where the borders are on a flat surface, but it's not enough for you to understand the shape of the land. You can see the borders, but not the shape. That's why we need a second source of image, which is going to be using this image, which is extracted from the Google Earth. I think it's very cool because it's a three-dimensional image where you can see the elevation, the curvature of the mountains and the land and everything. With these two images, I'm going to be showing you the land, what is in it, and what is located, everything. These two images, this one from the SIGPAC and this one from the Google Earth, I did extract them from here. This is the SIGPAC, a Spanish website. It's a very powerful tool for you to measure things on a real scale. If I zoom in here, for example, and put the edge of the parcels, the borders of the parcels, you can see that don't not only have our parcel there, but got other parcels as well. If I zoom off, you can see that every centimeter of Spain is registered by the Spanish government. So, you know, it's a very powerful tool. If I go to searches, which is consultas and parcels, and then pass the mouse there, it tells me exactly the size and the shape of our parcel, which is 1.156 hectares, which translates to 11,506 square meters. So it's a very powerful tool. Shows the shape of the land. There is the little house there, and got this kind of, I would say, rectangular shape with a little belly here on the side. So that's the same image we have right here. I'm gonna be working on that image soon. The second source of footage that I'm gonna be using is the Google Earth. I think this is so cool because it's a three-dimensional image. If I point here, zoom in, the house is more or less right on that spot there. You can see the curvature of the land going up that way on the mountain, and you can see the curvature of the land going up this way in the mountain, the road in the middle. And if I circle there, you can really kind of start to see the shape and everything. It's a fantastic tool, you know, for this, what I'm trying to achieve without a drone. I think it serves the purpose. So, you know, one particular thing that I want you to pay attention here is this little union of the two mountains, the lowest part of the land. I'll try to capture as much of this and to explain you on the future videos. But if you see, there is a kind of a sort of path. When rains from this mountain here, the water drains down there. When rains from this mountain here, the water drains down there. And then what happened? The water goes down the vale into this gap here. I can kind of try to rotate here to show you. Go into there. And then the water becomes visible. And then the water comes out of the ground. And then the water dumps into the river. This is the river Ebro. So, you know, is a very powerful tool for what we're trying to do here. We have a well in the property, an ancient well. This is the neighbor well here, and our well is somewhere there, following the path of the deepest path where the underground river goes by. With this image and that image, I'm gonna try to explain to you the land, what is in it, where is it located. And let's start from this image here from the SIGPAC, because this image is kind of the flat image where you see the shape and the borders of the land. I did some Photoshop work here, and I'm gonna show you the land itself highlighted with the border. I think that way is gonna be more interactive for we to understand, like, the shape of the land, which is kind of, I would say it's kind of rectangular shape with this kind of belly here. This image is going to help us a lot to achieve, like, to understand where everything is within the land. I did the same with this Google Earth image, where I kind of highlighted the land, where the land is, and following exactly the same path, a sort of a rectangular shape, but with the elevation, a 3D elevation. You can see that this part here is lower than that part there. With these two images, we're going to be able to achieve the visualization and understanding where the things are in the land. The stone house is old. It wasn't built only in one go. There is three different layers of stones and very distinct cut of stones and layering, which is show very clearly which is not from the same era. The foundations are very robust, very strong foundations. The second layer is not so great, and the third layer is really strong. So because the house has been probably done in one part and then been abandoned, then done again and been abandoned, done again and been abandoned, and now that is more than 100 years the house been abandoned, there are leaks on the roof, and then part of the house start to collapsing, and we are doing an emergency job in the house right now. I'm gonna post a video talking specific about that emergency job, but you know, is we kind of doing that because what the legislation in Spain say, you can only restore a part of the house or the house which has a roof. You cannot demolish and rebuild. So the house itself, the whole structure there, it got around 105 square meters, but where we have roof is only 59 square meters. So you see, we've got complications here. We can only restore the part which has roofs. I've seen some comments on the first video, why don't you demolish everything and rebuild from scratch? We cannot do that in Spain. If we let the house collapse completely, and then we have no house to restore. And this house is registered as a vivienda on the notary, so we can live there. So most of the house is registered as a casa de campo, which is a barn, which you cannot live legally there. So we can live legally there. The house itself is built of two floors. Upstairs was the living part. There is a fireplace, and it seems that everything was surrounding the fireplace. There was the living quarters, the sleeping quarters, everything at the same place. Downstairs was the corral, and that's where they keep the donkey and the livestock and also food supplies, things like that. It's very interesting how the people live there. Sometimes I'm sitting there and wondering, imagining how the people live there, how they dress up. I don't know much yet. I didn't have time to dig down that path yet. But yeah, so there's a lot of history to be discovered there still. And as they say in Spanish, poco a poco, step by step, we're gonna get there. So despite having been abandoned for a very long time, the walls on one part of the house are solid. These walls, which are solid, are made of the original foundations in the newer kind of stone laying. The other part that's collapsing was the second stage, second layer, or second time era of the house, which is not so great material, so the house is collapsing. I'm going to be doing a future content only about the house, because it's a complex building, and the way we're going to restore it is a bit complex as well. So you're going to be understanding, we're not going to take a lot of time. But this picture is the picture from the house. If you see, the trees are small here, because this picture here is from around 1969. This is when the previous owner bought the house back on that time. And more or less, the house is still the same, which the left side of the house, the picture here, is kind of collapsing now. We're doing an emergency job on this house. I'm going to be talking about that in a future videos. Yeah, let's crack on the content of this part here of the house, because it's an interesting one. You're going to see exactly where the house is located within the land. Let's start from the most important part of the land, which is the house, the stone house that we're going to restore. I want to make one thing very clear here. This stone house is old. It was not built in one time. It seems to be built in three generations, because there is three kind of different stone catches. One of the original footings, original foundations, another one with the part that's collapsing, and another one with the newer part. With the oldest part, I think that goes back to the same people who built the well, and I think that goes all the way back to the Phoenicians' time, which the Neolithic Iberic time. I'm still digging and researching to understand more on that, but the land on that shape there, the house sits on that corner of the land there. It's important to understand where it is. You start to grasp your ideas, where the things are located within the land. If I go to that image and show you the house is sitting right on that spot there. So on almost the lowest part of the land. Let me zoom in here and then you can see. It's like on that corner there, and sitting not so close to the edge, couple terraces under the edge, but not on the very bottom. A perfect place really for a house to be, in case it's too much rain. The house is not going to be flooded by the underground river that can go up to the surface. And whatever built that house, built on the perfect spot there. When I start to do this research looking for a piece of land in Spain, one of the criteria or priorities, if you will, that I use on my research was to purchase a land which has water, or at least a means of had water. And it took a while to find this land here, a land with a beautiful ancient well. There is water there on the well. And the interesting thing is the well is located on the lowest part of the land, right on the junction between two mountains. You're going to see on the footage that I create from the Google Earth, where exactly the position the well is located. The well is made from stones, and the technique for the stone cutting, the stone laying, is exactly the same kind of stones that we have on the foundations on the house. I reckon that the well and the foundations of the house, or the first stage of the house, they was building more or less on the same era. But before we use the well need to be restored and need to be cleaned. Once we be able to do that, and then the well is going to supply around between 300 and 500 liters of clean fresh water every day. There is a neighbor on the nearby Finca which has a well. He already did restore the well. This is what he taking on the dry season, around 300 liters, on the wet season, around 500 liters on a day. I think that's fantastic to have that availability of water. It's not going to be our only source of water, but we're going to have that source of water in the Finca. So this is an image I took back in September of the well. This left part of is collapsing here, and is amazing. It's really beautiful. The structure, the layout is odd. The oval shape, you're going to understand a little bit on the sequence of the footage here. So yeah, it's an interesting one, and I'm very blessed to have found this Finca, which has got its own source of water there. So let's check the continuation of this part. The ancient well, that well for the shape, which is very odd. I found nowhere that shape within Roman structures. The albanil, which is the bricklayer, the stone mason, and the architect, three of them told that this was from the Romans. I did a digo digging in Spain, and I realized that that shape of well was built by the Phoenicians, and that goes all the way back to the Neolithic Iberian time. I'm not saying it was built on that era, but it seems that it was built on that era. So it's sitting right there on alignment with the house. It's all this, isn't it? Because the house is there, the well is exactly on the same spot, same line where it is few terraces under. If I show you on the other image where the well is located right about there on the same kind of line, but if you follow the landscape on the lowest part of the landscape, so that's exactly where the well is located on the land there. So whatever built this well knew exactly what it was doing. So, you know, it's deep. I would say it's around 20 to 30 meters, but it's important to for you to get familiar where the things are located in the property. There's the house, that is the well. The people who were living in the finca there, these people, they was very smart. They kind of understood that on the dry season, there was less water, and on the rain season, there was more water. They built from, I think, from the same area, because the stone cuttings are very similar to the well and from the foundations of the house. And this is a rainwater collection cistern, or tank. Some parts of Spain they call jibe. And despite having cracks, you know, on the bottom because of the overgrown trees that grow too much, and there's a lot of fruits that made up inside the well and cracks, this cistern is still working. When it rains, it does collect the rain there, and but it needs a restoration, needs a repair. I measure the capacity of this rainwater cistern is around 5,000 liters of water can store it. And at some point in the past, it was in full working order. Now it's partially, there is about the water fill it up about 30, 40 centimeters, and then there's the cracks, then the water leaks. But it stays full all the time around that mountain of water there. And I think it's a very interesting and beautiful cistern. This pillar here looks like it's a pillar from an ancient structure. That stone there also, it looks like it's a pillar of an ancient structure. Maybe they collect these stones for some other project, or I don't know, from a local quarry, somewhere around. I could not even yet to figure out where was these stones brought from, but yeah, it's very functional. It's a piece of equipment there in the finca that we are blessed to have, and I'm gonna explain in the future videos how we're gonna restore it and how we're gonna reuse it combined with the newer technology that we have. So yeah, it's nice to have this feature on the farm for help during the dry and wet seasons. So let's check the footage from this part here for we understand a little bit more about the cistern. Another feature that we have, which is very interesting one, is the rain water collection cistern, which is located again aligned to the house on the top on the two terraces above the house, and that's got a solo purpose to collect water from the rain. So people, they was very smart. So I think on the dry times when there was no much rain, they used the well, and when it was rains, they stored the water for using when it was not raining, kind of that way. It's around 5,000 liters, and the well is around 20 to 30 meters. If you think about it, 5,000 liters seems to be not much, but these people did not have a running flush toilet, so, you know, for a couple with a kid here, I would say it's enough water for them to go by, to cultivate the land and everything. So when in future videos, I'm going to be saying, okay, this is where I'm going to be working today project, the rainwater cistern, you know, that's located on that spot. If I'm saying I'm working on the well, is located on that spot. That's the purpose I'm doing this video here, because to show you exact location where things are. On this image here, the cistern is located right there above the house, so it's not exactly you can't see the elevation. Really, you can see the sort of elevation, but it sits about above the house there. But it's all kind of in line from, that is the rain water catchment, that is the house, and that is the well. So three important things that we have in the finca there. One peculiar thing that we have in the house, which for me is a very nice feature, is that pine tree that I shoot some videos showing when I'm coming into the finca. That is this beautiful pine tree sitting there on the outside of the border of the land. It's not our pine tree, it's the neighbor's pine tree, but I find that very beautiful. So I would like to show you where it is located here for you to have an idea on the future content. So when I pass by the tree, you know that is I'm getting into or outside the property. Let me show you from this image where that pine tree is located. Is about there. When I come in into the road, I usually come from the town from that side there, and then comes down here, and that is where the pine tree is, right almost in the ramp that enters the land. So this is pretty much what we have in the land right now. We have the house, we have the well, and we have the rain water collection cistern. Three important features, and I want to show them first because the house, the well, and the rainwater cistern collection is what we have in the land right now. We bought the land knowing that was these things all need to be restored, but it's possible, it's doable to restore these things. When we bought the finca, we didn't have access to the property. At first we was using the neighbor's land to access, because you need to go down the little road and then pass through our land and then go around the neighbor's land. Not ideal to do that. We didn't know the neighbor. Now we know. We spoke to the neighbor, told him that we've been using the land for some time. He said it's okay, no problem. And because of that problem, we need to work on a solution, which was building a ramp. And we contacted the local tractor guy, and then he came and he widened the road, and also he cut some trees. Unfortunately, we need to let three or four trees go away for be able to have this access to the land. In future, we're going to replant some trees and it's going to make up for what we lost now. But the good thing is now we have access to the finca. Not only that, because we made the ramp very wide. This is a picture taken back in December 2022. That's when we did the ramp. And it's wide enough for passing the trucks. So when you're going to, we kind of future-proofing the things here. When it be the time to restore in the house, we already have the road in place for the trucks coming in, delivering water, delivering building material, and delivering whatever is needed for us to be able to restore the house and the land and everything. I think it was a smart choice to do this right on the outset, because now we don't need to access the neighbor's land, we don't need to disturb his trees there. He got already full production olive trees there, beautiful trees, and they giving a lot of high quality olive oil. And yeah, so we're very pleased with that. So let's check the footage here for you guys see, you know, a little bit more about this road that we have to open. The first project is the access to the land. We did not have an access to the land, so we need to build a road, which I call new road, a ramp, if you will. And that ramp, this is the image like from the new road that we opened. Unfortunately, we need to cut a couple of the olive trees that was overpopulated here. They were sitting there. We need to cut them to open, because how we was accessing the land, you've seen some images from earlier videos where I drove the car and I carried that IBC on the top. So we kind of entered the land here, and was a tiny road. Then we need to go on the neighbor's land, which is not ideal. I didn't know the neighbor. Now I know he was all right. I told him that I used a few times and I need to use, and he said it was okay. And then we delivered the things in the house there. So that was a problem that I need a solution. I found the tractor guy. The guy came in and opened the road, make the road more workable. So now the trucks, when we start the renovation, can come deliver building materials, can deliver water and whatever we need for the land there. I think it's gonna be cool. Let me show you where the ramp is located on this image. The ramp is located right there. It has an sort of elevation from the road, and then it has a drop for a couple of terraces, and then that kind of align with the house where it is. For you to have an idea where the car we was using access was more or less right there, because we go down and then we was coming down to the neighbor's land, and then from there accessing the house from the side of the house, which was not ideal. That's why we kind of prioritize this as the first projects to make this ramp open, for we don't need to molest the neighbor and use his land. We were very blessed to find this piece of land with so many mature olive trees. According to the SIGPAC, which is the official Spanish Ministry of Agriculture satellite platform, we have more than 100 olive trees, mature olive trees in the property. Because they not been carried for more than 100 years, there is a lot of work needs to be done before the first harvest. We need to prune, we need to cut, we need to look after the trees. This is very exciting for us, because once we do this initial work needs to be done on the trees, this is a good quality, mature olive trees. It's gonna give good fruits and also good olive oil. I know that because they both fincas, one side and the other, they in full production, and they have really good quality olives, and we have the same kind of olives there as well. So, you know, this picture here was taken back in December 2022. This one was taken when the tractor guy was clearing the land. So took a lot of work to start to clear this. Now you can see how overgrown the trees are, and there's a lot of work, but there's a lot of possibilities as well. I'm going to show you where the trees are located within the land, because there is a lot, not all land, and you're gonna understand why, but they are spread around. And yeah, so let's check the footage. One last thing that I want to show on the project, it is the olive trees that we have in the property, because I didn't have time yet to talk about them. And I think this is the right place. If I put this image here, it gives the idea where the olive trees are. It's not 100%, but gives the idea where they are located. We have around 103 trees. I didn't count them yet, but it's around. That's what the SIGPAC tell us. And we have all olive trees. All the green dots are olive trees around the property. There is a few carob trees. We got 3 or 4 carob trees. One carob tree is there. Another 2 is around there. And one is, I see around here. Might be some carob trees where the pine trees are, but the green ones here are all olive trees, mature olive trees that need to be pruned. And when they'll be pruned, I would say that every 2 years they're gonna give us around 200 up to 200 liters of pure olive oil. So I guess that's more or less the average. They are beautiful and it's nice looking. And hopefully when we prune in everything, they're gonna look nice. They're already nice, they just overgrown. They need to be trimmed. Let me show you the olive trees from this side for you to see the perspective where they are. So there is olive trees from this side. That is where that void is. That is where the pine trees are. There's a few carob trees around here. I seen one from the road right here. Might be some here. And is one on that edge there. All of those are olive trees, around 103, maybe more, maybe less. I need to count them and everything, but this is how the olive trees are on the project. So yeah, so this is what I want to show you on this video. I think this is it for this project overview video. On this video, I have talked a little bit about the land, the stone house, the well, the cistern, the road and the ramp, and also the olive trees. I hope you enjoyed the way I use the satellite images to demonstrate where things are located within the Finca. And if you'd like to check more information about us, about the project, I'm going to leave the link down below of our blog, eridulife.com, so you can check the blog or the information there. Also, you can check the links for our other social medias and the contents that I'm writing there. Because during the winter times when I was in the Finca, I have the problem with the batteries. I could not shoot the video, but I could take pictures. So from those times where I could not shoot videos, I'm going to be writing articles. And I'm going to be very interesting, very in-depth, and nice articles. Yeah, so check the information about us and about the project on the blog. I'm going to leave the links down in the description. If you would like to support and help us with the Eridu Life project, you can do so through Patreon or GoFundMe. Your support and help will go towards the stone house restoration. All the links is down the description. And that's it for this video. Thank you for watching.